Well, hello, gentlemen. Thank you for joining me today. This is an exciting chapter, the last chapter of Matthew. But not because it's the end of the study of Matthew, it's because it's the story of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the bedrock of our faith. So let's talk about it for just a moment. After the agony and the darkness of the last chapter, we come to this blessed event that's filled with awe and wonder and worship. All the gospel writers tell the resurrection story. Matthew's is a little briefer than all the rest of them. Remember, he's writing to Jewish Christians, and he wants to give just the brief introduction, to what it means in relationship to Jesus rising from the dead. So he doesn't deal with a lot of details. He just gives an overview of all that has happened regarding the resurrection. But what he really deals with, and he wants his disciples to know, is the responsibility at the end of the resurrection that we all have. So let's just talk briefly about this chapter for a moment. Jesus had died on the cross, and he was buried before sundown in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. The chief priests and the elders had decided that they wanted some guards posted at the tomb. They didn't want any chance of Jesus escaping or the disciples coming and taking the body. And so before dawn on Sunday, there's a tremendous event that unfolds at the tomb. There's an earthquake, and then there's an angel that comes dressed like lightning and frightens the soldiers to death so much that they faint and fall on the ground. Two women come, at least two Marys, and they recognize the angel. And the angel says, "Don't be afraid." And they weren't. And the angel said what all of creation was waiting to hear, that Jesus is risen from the dead, and to go and tell his disciples that Jesus will meet them in Galilee. So the women quickly leave, as the angel had instructed them to do, and they go, and on the way, they're met by Jesus. They fall on the ground, they worship him, and he tells them just exactly what the instructions of the angel was, to go into Galilee and meet the disciples and tell them that Jesus will meet them there in Galilee. Meanwhile, the temple guards who had fainted goes to the chief priests and tells them what's happened. They concoct a story. Tell everybody that you fell asleep, and the disciples of Jesus came and stole the body. So, excuse me. They also told him that if word comes to Pilate, because of course death was certain for any soldier who went to sleep on the job. So already from the moment of Jesus' resurrection, lies were being told. So Jesus meets his disciples. Some believed, some worshiped, and some were skeptical. On the mountain, Jesus gives his disciples the task that they are to do after he's gone. Now, let's get back to the very beginning of the story, where the soldiers go to the chief priests and they tell their story. I want to deal with three issues today of the resurrection story. People who have told lies about the resurrection and refute some of those ideas that the resurrection never happened. First of all, the soldiers sleeping. Now, sleeping on the job, as I said, was punishable by death by any Roman soldier. So no soldier would, first of all, ever admit that he was sleeping on the job. Number one. Number two, if they were sleeping, how would they ever know that the disciples of Jesus came and stole the body? Thirdly, in relationship to the soldiers, there's no way that the chief priests had enough pull with Pilate to tell Pilate not to punish the soldiers. To do that would be setting a precedent that would never be lived out in the Roman Empire. So, as a result of that, the soldier's story obviously is untrue. A second thought about the resurrection is what we call the swoon theory. The swoon theory is simply saying that Jesus really didn't die on the cross. He just went into a swoon. He went into a sleep. And at some point afterwards, while Jesus was in the tomb, he regained consciousness and found a way to escape. Now, if you can believe that, it takes more faith to probably believe that than it simply does to believe that he rose from the dead. But let's just look at it for a moment. Jesus had 6-inch spikes driven into his hands and into his feet. And his body hung on the cross, and he could no longer pull himself up to breathe. His side was pierced, and blood and water flowed, according to John. And this was likely a reference to the spear piercing the heart of Jesus and a mixture of blood and watery serum pouring out, a confirmation of death. His Roman executioners did not break his legs, which is normal, so they couldn't get down from the cross because they'd already determined that he was dead. Now, as a professional executioner, a soldier would never allow himself to make that mistake, for they would themselves face death if they made a mistake in that matter. These men would have been certain that Jesus was dead. Fourthly, Pilate confirmed that he was dead. He would not make that mistake either in relationship to the stakes that were very high in the public forum. And then when you think about it, Jesus was embalmed with about 75 pounds of ointments and spices and wrapped in bondages to the point where someone who passed out would have never been able to endure such treatment and survive, let alone breathe through all of those bandages and so forth that was wrapped around him. And then when you think about it, the tomb was sealed with a stone that probably weighed around 2,000 pounds. So think about this weakened body just waking up and trying to remove that stone and step out of that tomb with all those soldiers there and guarding the tomb. So if Jesus could have revived and moved the heavy stone, he'd have never been able to escape the soldiers. Then probably the most popular refutation of the resurrection is what we call the three-day controversy. You see, 3 days to us means 72 hours. But you have to understand that the Bible historically and culturally and in relationship to that, for the Jewish custom, any part of a day, any hours of a day was considered a full day. So a few hours on Friday, a few and all day Saturday, and Sunday morning, a few hours, would be considered 3 days. Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So there's no controversy historically or culturally regarding the three-day idea that Jesus was in the tomb 3 days and rose again. So Matthew skips over all the appearances by Jesus in Jerusalem, and he jumps right to the meeting with Jesus and the disciples. So let's turn to the story itself. The guards were afraid. It always amuses me. Here's these battle-tested soldiers really being afraid, so much so that they pass out and go unconscious, laying on the ground. But the women come, who've never probably been in a battle themselves in their lives, and while they are fearful, they certainly don't pass out, and they carry on a conversation with the angel. So, I love what Adam Clark says. The resurrection of Christ is a subject of terror to the servants of sin, and a subject of consolation to the sons of God, because it is a proof of the resurrection of both the one to shame and everlasting contempt, and the other to eternal joy and glory. For the first time, these faithful women heard that all creation is trying to hear, and that is that Jesus was not in the tomb, but had risen from the dead. And the angels said, go tell the disciples. Go on the mountain and tell the disciples. The angel commanded them to be the first witnesses and messengers of the good news of Jesus' resurrection. I like that, because these women were some of the few people courageous enough to identify themselves with Jesus, and it was an appropriate honor for them to be the first to hear of the resurrection of Jesus. So, can I just say here that when the women began their journey to be obedient to the angel's instructions, they met none other than Jesus himself. I can tell you, when we are obedient to the Word of God, when we are obedient to the message that God has given to us, somewhere along the line, Jesus connects with us. It's always certain that Jesus connects with his disciples, people who are obedient to him. Interesting that what Jesus said and the angels said was the same. Jesus said to the women, go to the mountains and go to the disciples, tell them to meet me in Galilee. It came from the same source, so it ought not to be surprised. What Jesus did say here is something that he'd never said before. And he said, don't be afraid. Go tell my brethren to go to Galilee. Jesus had never called them brethren. But at this point in time, I think it was imperative for Jesus to let these disciples know that in spite of their cowardice, in spite of their unbelief, Jesus still believed in them, and he called them his brothers. I love what Mark says in Mark chapter 16, when it says the same thing. It says, go and tell my disciples and Peter. I love that, especially Peter. Be sure Peter knows that I want to meet him in Galilee. Why Peter? Well, you know, Peter denied Jesus openly. While the others were a little bit more subtle in their discrediting Jesus and not believing in him, after all that he had told them that he would rise from the dead, they still didn't believe. But he singled out Peter for that moment. But he singled out all of the disciples, and he calls them brothers. Isn't it interesting that today there are people who don't believe in the Holocaust? It's one of the most recorded events of all history, yet there are still who say it never happened. Same is true of the resurrection. There are people who believe that it never happened. Jesus wasted no time. He wanted his disciples to understand this ragtag band of young men who just had unbelief written all over them. He wanted them to know he had a task for them. And so he calls them into the mountains, at a haunt that they had probably previously been to many times before. And there he says to them, look, all authority has been given to me. You remember when Jesus was tempted, Satan said he'd give him all these things? He could have all this authority? Satan didn't have that to give, but Jesus got it when he died on the cross and rose from the tomb, all that authority, everything, was given to him. And based on that authority, Jesus says to his disciples, guys, this is what I want you to do. I have the authority to command you to do thus and thus. It wasn't a suggestion, it was a command. I want you to go into all the world, preach the gospel. You know, Jesus had spent most of his time with the Jews. Seldom, on a few occasions, did he enter in conversation with any other people but the Jews. But now Jesus changes his whole strategy and his whole story. And aren't you glad? Go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. When Paul heard the voice from the man from Macedonia to come and to help him, that's when we became a part of this all of the world. Because most of our ancestors came from Europe and that part of the world. So when Paul listened to the voice of the Spirit and went to Macedonia, we heard the message from Paul's message, faithfulness in preaching the gospel in Macedonia. And so as Jesus speaks to his disciples, he says, I want you to make disciples of all nations. Disciples is not just made by conversion. Disciples are made by teaching, by learning. The idea behind the word disciples is scholars, students, learners. Disciples are made. They're not spontaneously created at conversion. They're a product of a process involving other believers. That's you and me. The making of disciples is the power of spreading Christianity. Jesus said, I want you to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He didn't tell them to go circumcise them. He said, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The experience of God in these three persons is the essential basis of discipleship. The content is, teach them all things that I have commanded you. We, as the followers of Jesus, are responsible to present the whole counsel of God to those who are made disciples. But here's the key, guys. We don't do this by ourselves. Jesus said, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age, and that's talking about us. And so just because we're in an era where God and Christianity is waning, and we talk about it being the post-Christian era, doesn't mean we stop making disciples. And we can't use the excuse because God's not with us, because Jesus said, lo, I am with you to the end of the age. Jesus sent his disciples with a mission to fulfill, but he didn't send them alone. And then there's one word at the end of the chapter which seals it all. And that's the word, amen. That word, amen, says, let it be so. Guys, we weren't there to witness the resurrection. We weren't there on the mountain to listen to the command that Jesus gave the disciples. But we are here today in this age, and we are called to make disciples. And Jesus said, guys, I'm with you to the end of the age. Are we going to be disciple makers? Someone discipled you. Amen.